Okay. We're solving nonlinear systems. On this example, if the directions on your notes say solve using substitution, and we said at the top of your notes, sometimes we might have two equations where they're both linear. We might have a system of equations where you have a single quadratic where only one variable is squared. You might have a dual quadratic equation, and that's where you have equations where both the x is squared and the y is squared. And so on this one, we just have one quadratic equation, and when you look at this, I hope you recognize this one is a line. And this one, when we only have one squared variable, is a parabola. So what we're really trying to figure out on this one is where this line and this parabola intersect. And so the directions on this one said solve by substitution. We know we need to isolate one variable. It'd be pretty easy to isolate y. So if we add 1 on both sides, then x squared plus 1 equals y. You know what that looks like if you were to graph it. It's your parabola, your parent parabola, shifted up 1. And this one is a line. So if we solve by substitution, when we have y isolated, you never substitute in yourself. You always substitute into the other equation. Everywhere you see y, y is out. X squared plus 1 is in. So 4x minus all of x squared plus 1 equals negative 1. Or 4x, distribute the negative sign, minus x squared minus 1 equals negative 1. That's a quadratic equation. We want to put it in standard form. We're going to want to make it equal 0. So we're going to add 1 to both sides. And now it equals 0. And if I put this in standard form, I'll have negative x squared plus 4x equals 0. And when we have a quadratic equation, we usually try to factor it first. So we can factor out either an x or a negative x. We factor out an x, then negative x. X times negative 4 equals 0. So we have two possibilities because we're using the zero product property that says if two things multiply to be zero, then one of them has to be zero. So either x equals zero or negative x minus 4 equals 0, which then if I add 4 to both sides, negative x equals 4, and divide both sides by negative 1, then x equals negative 4. So we have two possible x values. Oops, what did I do?
Should the 4 be positive?
It should be positive, shouldn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you didn't take
it
out
would be negative x plus 4.
Yeah, this should be a negative x plus 4. There we go. So then the x is a negative. A negative x divided by a negative 1 turns into a positive 4. And then each one of these x values has a y value to go with it. So if we come back up to here, the y value is whatever x is squared plus 1. So a y value 0 squared plus 1 will just give us 1. And if x is 4 and we plug in, y equals 4 squared plus 1 gives us y equals 17. When you're solving nonlinear systems, I want you to always write all your solutions, all possible solutions, as ordered pairs. So on this one, when x is 0, y is 1, and when x is 4, y is 17. So if we did a quick sketch of this one, we know that the first one, y equals x squared plus 1, is a parent graph shifted, parent parabola shifted up 1. If I was going to graph the line 4x minus y equals negative 1, I would want to solve for y to graph this line quickly. So negative y equals negative 4x minus 1, or y equals positive 4x plus 1. Is that good? And so this line would go across the y-axis at 0, 1, and it would have a slope of 4, rise 1, 2, 3, 4, run 1. So there's a line, something like this. Do you agree that if we extend the parabola and we extend the line, they're going to intersect up here somewhere, and they're going to intersect at 417, but they also have the point 01 in common? Okay? Example 2. Let's look at that one. This one says solve using substitution. Back before Christmas, we talked about circles, and a circle has an equation x squared plus y squared equals r squared. That's if its center is at 0, 0. This is a circle, but it's not centered at 0, 0. What does x minus 1 cause? That shifts right 1, and y minus 1 will shift up 1. So this thing is a circle, and it has a center at 1, 1. And what about its radius?
The square root of 5.
Yeah. The radius is square root of 5. I was going to be smart and graph this ahead of time, but I really didn't graph it right. If the radius is the square root of 5, that's about a little bit more than 2. So center is at 1, 1, and the radius is about a little more than 2 this way, a little more than 2 this way, a little more than 2 this way. Will somebody grab that? A little more than 2 this way. And tell them I'll call them back in a minute.
Yes. Okay. They need candles in the counter.
They do?
Goodness.
You're coming back, right?
Yeah.
Okay. No. So there's a picture of the circle, and what is this one?
A line.
Okay. So if you graph a circle and a line, they might have no points in common. They might have one point in common. It could be the circle and the line do this. It could be that the circle and the line do this. It could be that the circle and the line do this. So we're trying to figure out what's going on here. And so if we isolate a variable, the one that's the easiest to isolate is x. And if we get x by itself, then subtract 2y. So x is negative 2y. Then in the other equation, everywhere we see an x, we're going to replace it with negative 2y. And it looks like this. Negative 2y minus 1 all squared plus y minus 1 all squared equals 5. So we got to expand these out. So negative 2y minus 1 times negative 2y minus 1 plus y minus 1 times y minus 1 equals 5. Or where do we land? 4y squared, positive 2y, and another positive 2y will make it positive 4y, last times last, plus 1, and then y squared plus y squared, negative y, and another negative y is minus 2y, last times last, plus 1. This is quadratic. We're going to want to make it equal 0, so I'm going to go ahead and say minus 5 equals 0. So 4y squared and another y squared gives us 5y squared. 4y and negative 2y gives us 2y. What else do we have? 1 plus 1, that's 2, minus 5, negative 3 equals 0. This is a quadratic equation. I think we worked on it last time. So I will just tell you this factors. It factors to be y plus 1 times 5y minus 3 equals 0. So we have two possible y values. Y is either negative 1, or 5y minus 3 equals 0 means 5y equals 3, so y equals 3/5. So we have two possible y values, and each one of those y values has an x value to go with it. So go back to here. X is equal to negative 2 times whatever y is, negative 1. In this case, x equals 2. And if we write this as an ordered pair, because that's what I want you to do on all of these systems, we'll have 2, negative 1. If y is 3/5, then x is negative 2 times 3/5, straight across the top, straight across the bottom. That gives us x is negative 6/5. this ordered pair is negative 6/5, comma 3/5. So here's our two solutions. Our line and our circle have 2 points in common. If I graph x equals 2y, I know that's a line. If I were going to graph it, I would really want to solve for y. So 2y equals negative x, divide by 2, y equals negative 1/2 x. For graphing purposes, I'd rather have y by itself. This tells me it goes across the y-axis at 0, 0. It has a slope of negative 1/2, so down 1, right 2, and if I draw the line, something like this, you would probably believe that this point right here could be 2, negative 1. It's not graphed extremely accurately, but this point is out negative 1 and 1/5, negative 6/5. Up 3/5. It's not a completely accurate graph, but I think from graphing it, you believe the solutions that we have. Are you okay? All right. One more. Number 3 says solve using the elimination method. So we got to decide, do we want to eliminate x squared or do we want to eliminate y squared? And by the way, these are not circles. Because there's a multiplier in front of an x squared. Remember what a multiplier does? Instead of just 1x squared plus 1y squared equals r squared, we got 3x squared. That causes it to stretch or shrink in the x direction, stretch or shrink in the y direction. So if it was a circle but we stretched it.
It's an ellipse.
It's an ellipse. It's not round anymore. It's more of an oval shape. So it's an ellipse. So what could happen if you have two ellipses? I'll just give you some quick scenarios. You could have two ellipses that don't have any points in common, which would mean no solution. You could graph two ellipses that have one point in common. You could graph two ellipses that have 2 points in common. Could you have two ellipses that have 3 points in common? Ellipses have a major axis and a minor axis, and we're going to talk about this eventually. These I've been drawing all are longer in the x direction, so the major axis is horizontal. But if you have two ellipses where one has a horizontal axis and one has a vertical axis, then those have 3 points in common. Or you could even have two ellipses that have 4 points in common. So you got to be ready for the possibility that this could have no solution, one solution, two solutions, three solutions, or four solutions. So we're going to start solving and figure out which one it is. Which one do you want to eliminate?
Y.
Okay. If we eliminate y, then we're going to turn both of them into sixes. One of them a positive six, one of them a negative six. So let's multiply the top equation by 3 all the way across on both sides. Bottom equation by negative 2 all the way across on both sides. Then top equation turns into 9x squared plus 6y squared. 35 times 3 is 105. Okay. And then negative 8x squared positive 6y squared equals negative 96. When we add, oops, I messed up. Y'all didn't yell at me. Negative 6y squared. And then when we add 6y squared and negative 6y squared, eliminate. So we have just 1x squared equals 9. And then to solve for x, take the square root of both sides. So x is, what do you have to remember?
Plus or minus 3.
So if you forget plus or minus, you're going to leave off some of the solutions. So we got to consider, all right, if x equals 3, there's a y value that goes with it. If x equals negative 3, there's a y value, 4 values to go with it. So if we plug back into the top equation, 3 times 3 squared plus 2 times y squared equals 35, then do the exponent first, 3 squared, 9 times 3, so we have 27 plus 2y squared equals 35. If we subtract 27 from both sides, then 2y squared equals 8. And divide by 2, so that means
y squared equals
4. When you take the square root of both sides, so you can't leave off the plus or minus. So if y is plus or minus 2, and I want you to write all solutions as ordered pairs, when x is 3, y is either 2, or when x is 3, y could be negative 2. So you'll have two ordered pairs from that, 3, 2, and 3, negative 2. And if x is negative 3, what happens? If you plug negative 3 back into the top, you'll have 3 times, it's going to be the same, right? Other than you have to make a note of, oh, that gives me two more ordered pairs. Because negative 3 squared turns into 27 plus 2y squared equals 35, exactly the same thing. So when we solve, again, we'll have y equals plus or minus 2. So that gives us two different ordered pairs. When x is negative 3, y is positive 2, or when x is negative 3, y is negative 2. So this system has four solutions, which, if you graphed it, we would have two ellipses that look something like this that intersect at 3, 2, and 3, negative 2, and negative 3, 2, and negative 3, negative 2. Make sense? Stop that for a minute. More solving nonlinear systems. Example 4 on your notes says solve using elimination. When you first glance at this equation, elimination is probably not the first thing that comes to your mind. You would probably say, well, y is already by itself, why don't we just substitute? And you could just substitute, but sometimes elimination works, and so I want you to see that one. If you're going to use elimination, though, you've got to make both of these equations look like they're in the same form. So I need the x squared to be on the other side. So that top equation becomes negative x squared. It has no y squared, so I'm going to move over a little bit. Then plus y equals 5. And the bottom equation, x squared plus y squared, there's nothing like a y squared, equals 25. Well, we know when we do elimination, we add. If we just add, these eliminate, we have left y squared plus y equals 30, which is a quadratic equation. So we want to make it equal 0. Y squared plus y minus 30 equals 0. And then we're going to want to factor it, and it'll factor. Y multiplies to be negative 30 and adds to be 1. Positive 6 and negative 5 does it. Good. So 0 product, two things multiply to give us an answer of 0. Either y plus 6 equals 0, which tells us y equals negative 6, or y minus 5 equals 0, which tells us y equals 5. And then each one of these y values has an x to go with it. So if I plug negative 6 in for this y, negative 6 equals x squared plus 5. If I subtract 5 from both sides, I get negative 11 equals x squared. And then if we take the square root of both sides, what kind of number is this?
An imaginary.
I square root of 11 is the x value. So when y equals negative 6, there's not a real point of intersection. But if y equals 5, what happens here? If you plug 5 in for y, then 5 equals x squared plus 5. And if you subtract 5 from both sides, 0 equals x squared.
X equals 0.
When you take the square root of 0, it's just 0. So x equals 0. So what is our ordered pair solution?
0, 5.
0, 5. Now let's see if that makes sense. What's the first thing if you graph it?
The y.
Y equals x squared plus 5. You know that. That's just your parent parabola graph shifted up 5. What about this second one? We've talked about it enough.
It's circle.
It's a circle. Where is it centered? Zero, zero, because nothing's caused it to shift. It's a circle. With the center at zero, zero, what's its radius?
Five.
So if you make a little sketch of a circle centered at zero, zero, one, two, three, four, five, one, two, three, four, five, five, all directions, then my rough sketching is not very good, but anyway. There's a circle, and if you graph a parabola, a parent parabola shifted up 5,
you get 1.
I only have 1 point in common, and what would it be?
0.5.
You could also solve this by substitution. If you didn't follow the directions and you solved by substitution instead of elimination, everywhere you see a Y, you would replace it, and it would look like, if we did substitution instead of elimination, we'd be solving x squared plus 5 instead of y, but then y's got to be squared equals 25. Do you see how that would work? It would get a little bit uglier than this. It'll work the same. We're about to do one like this in the next example. So I'm not going to finish this, but I want you to know if you did finish this, you would still get 5, 0. This is example 5. On example 5, a planet's orbit follows a path described by this equation. This is an ellipse. So some planet is orbiting in an elliptical path. And then a comet follows this parabolic path. So a comet's doing this thing, looking like a parabola. And there is a possibility that they could intersect. If you graph an ellipse and a parabola, how many times could they intersect? Well, you could have an ellipse and a parabola that never touch. You could have an ellipse and a parabola that have 1 point in common. You could have an ellipse and a parabola that have 2 points in common. Could you do more?
Yeah.
You could have an ellipse and a parabola that would have 3 points in common. Or you could have an ellipse and a parabola that have 4 points in common. So you have to be ready that when you're solving an ellipse, a system involving an ellipse and a parabola, you might find no solution, 1 solution, 2, 3, or 4 solutions. So it doesn't tell us how to solve this one. We could do elimination. We could do this one like we did this. But I want to show you the other option. If you do substitution, then everywhere you see a Y, you got to replace it with x squared minus 4. And you got to realize, you got to be careful and realize that y is squared. So you'll have 16x squared plus 4 times x. Y is out, x squared minus 4 is in.
Squared.
But y is squared, so this is squared, equals 64. So 16x squared plus 4 times all of what we get when we do x squared minus 4 times x squared minus 4, and it's going to equal 64. So it gets kind of messy, but you can do it. 16x squared plus 4 times
x to the 4th.
Mm-hmm.
Minus 8x squared.
Yeah, we'll have minus 4x squared and another minus 4x squared, so we'll have 8x squared last times last plus 16 equals 64. So we got to distribute the 4. That'll make it 16x squared plus 4x to the 4th, 4 times negative 8, negative 32x squared, 4 times 16, plus 64. It's a higher order equation because it's got an x to the 4th in it. So we know we're going to want to make it equal 0. I'm going to go ahead and subtract 64 and make it equal 0. So if I write the biggest exponent first, 4x to the 4th, we got 16 minus 32, so that's minus 16x squared. And then 64 minus 64 goes away, equals 0.
Take out a 4x squared.
So let's take out a 4x squared, because this is a higher order equation, and when we get lucky, higher order equations solve by factoring. And when we don't get lucky, then we got to use the rational root theorem, and y'all love that. But this one factors, so we can take out a 4x squared, and then that gives us x squared minus 4 equals 0, which
a difference of 2 squared.
Is a difference of 2 squared. So 4x squared times
x plus 4x minus 4.
X plus 2, x minus 2. So how many possible solutions do we have here for x?
4.
Either 4x squared equals 0, or x plus 2 equals 0, or x minus 2 equals 0. And if you divide both sides by 4, you end up with x squared equals 0. And when you take the square root of 0, it's just 0. And if you subtract 2 from both sides, then x is negative 2. Or add 2 on both sides, and x is positive 2. So we have three situations. If x is 0, we got to find y. I would go back to y equals x squared minus 4. So y equals 0 squared minus 4. Or that just gives us y equals negative 4. So one solution to this system is 0, negative 4. Another solution, if x is negative 2, then y is negative 2 all squared minus 4. Or y equals 4 minus 4. Y equals 0. So another solution that we have is negative 2, 0. And if x is positive 2, then you got to find the y that goes with that. Well, positive 2 squared minus 4 will also turn into just 4 minus 4, and we'll get 0 again. So the ellipse and the parabola have three possible points of intersection: at 0, negative 4, at negative 2, 0, and at positive 2, 0. Okay. On example 6, you're told that this figure shows a square floor plan that has a smaller area that will accommodate a combination fountain and pool. We're going to put a pool and a fountain right here. And here's the floor area that we're going to put it on. And the floor area with the pool and the fountain removed has this, meaning this irregular shape right here, has an area of 21 and a perimeter of 24 meters. And this problem asks us to find the dimensions of the regular floor and this pool area. So when we get finished, we'll know dimensions for the big square and dimensions for the small square.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we need two equations because we've got two things we don't know. So help me write two equations. If area of the big square is 21, or area of this irregular shape is 21, then the big square
would be x squared.
Okay, and then we got a cookie cutter out this. So we would have x squared
minus y squared
equals 21.
Mm-hmm.
Then we got to get perimeter. Perimeter means add all the way around this thing. So we have an x plus another x. So that'll give us three x's. The problem is we got to add this and this,
mm-hmm.
but we don't have those pieces. So how could we represent this and this?
You could do x minus y.
Because this whole thing is x, but we're taking this piece out.
Mm-hmm.
So x plus x plus x is 3x, plus another x minus y gets us these two pieces, and then three more y's.
Yes.
And when we add all of those, it's got to equal 24.
Mm-hmm.
So where are we? 4x plus 2y
equals
24. Let's divide everything by 2 and make these numbers smaller. So 2x plus y equals 12.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't specify how we solve this. So if we do substitution, then y will equal negative 2x plus 12.
Mm-hmm.
And then everywhere we see a y in the other equation, y's out. Negative 2x plus 12 is in. Okay, she's at lunch.
Okay, thank you.
Uh-huh. So, x squared minus, instead of y, we got to subtract off all of negative 2x plus 12 equals 21.
Squared.
Squared.
Yeah.
Thank you. So, x squared minus all of y squared equals 21.
Mm-hmm.
So x squared, and here we have to be careful because we got to subtract off all of what we get when we square negative 2x plus 12. So x squared minus, help me here, we end up with
4x
squared.
Yeah, 4x squared.
And
minus 24x.
And another minus 24, we'll make that minus 48x, and then plus 144 equals 21.
Mm-hmm.
So we got to subtract off all of this. That makes it x squared
minus
4x squared.
Plus 48x plus 144, or minus 144.
Minus 144, and then it's quadratic, so we're going to want to make it equal 0, so we'll say minus 21 equals 0. So where are we? Negative 3x squared.
Plus 48x minus 165 equals 0.
And I think we got lucky because all of these should divide by 3, or divide by, so let's divide everything. Oops, I left off my x. Divide everything by negative 3 and make our equation smaller. So x squared, 16 times 3, so minus 16x, and this turns into plus 55 equals 0.
Yes.
And I think this one will factor. So we're looking for what multiplies by 55 and adds to be negative 16.
It should be negative 11 and negative 5.
And so we find out that x is either 11 or x is 5.
Mm-hmm.
And each one of these x's has a y value that goes with it. So if we go back over here,
mm-hmm.
the y value that goes with it is negative 2 times 11 plus 12, or negative 22 plus 12.
Or negative 10.
Or negative 10. Negative 10 is not going to work as a y value,
mm-hmm.
right? So this one, we're throwing out. It's not what we want. But if x is 5, the y value that goes with it is negative 2 times 5 plus 12, or negative 10 plus 12, or y equals 2.
Mm-hmm.
That would make sense with this. So if x is 5 and y is 2, then the dimensions of the floor... The floor dimensions are 5 by 5, and the pool fountain dimensions are 2 by 2.
Mm-hmm.
Make sense?